Thank you everyone for joining us tonight. It's nice to be here. I appreciate the opportunity. I'd like to thank everyone at Crossroads and Fund Innovate for this opportunity. Tonight, we're going to talk a little bit about a subject that is near and dear to most orthopedic foot and ankle surgeons and podiatrist heart, the first metatarsal phalangeal joint fusion. It's a super common procedure and a workhorse procedure for many of us. So without further ado here, and background, Lisa went over this a little bit. I'm originally from New York. I trained at Upstate Medical University for medical school, and I did my residency at Geisinger and fellowship with Paul Giuliano at Penn State Hershey. And it should be noted that conflict of interest, I'm a paid consultant for Crossroads. Principles of first MTP arthrodesis. So indications for this problem, most commonly hallux rigidus. In some cases, this is something that we use for severe hallux valgus. For inflammatory arthritis, certainly an excellent solution. Post-traumatic arthritis, or in many cases, a salvage procedure for either a failed hallux valgus procedure or a non-union of a previous first metatarsal phalangeal joint fusions. And while there's quite a number of reasons you perform this procedure, the goals are similar. You want a correction of deformity and you want pain relief. And for that, this is a very reliable and excellent procedure that has been done since, I believe it was first described in 1852. So something that's been around for a long time. Whenever you're talking about fusion, you know, we follow the basic AO principles, the same principles we use for fracture fixation. You want to do it in a way where you try to minimize dissection and preserve blood supply. The goal of the procedure is to obtain an anatomic reduction in alignment. You want to fixate the fusion with rigid fixation. And rigid fixation allows for a higher rate of fusion, but it also allows for early mobilization. And when I learned how to do this during my training, there were a couple different ways. Done everything from old-fashioned crossed solid screws, plates and lag screws, and just plates. Some doctors up in Pennsylvania when I was training were still using simply K-wires for this. Not something that I've seen in a real long time. But, you know, if you're thinking about first MTP fusion as a procedure and if you're going to build a construct to make your first MTP fusion heal, you know, in my mind, there are a couple of key things that you want to achieve. The holy grail, I think, for a first metatarsal phalangeal joint fusion is something that's going to be biomechanically sound. The ideal construct for a fusion in this joint would be a plantar tension band construct. The main deforming force post-operatively is going to be dorsiflexion of the hallux during terminal stance and push-off. When you're performing this procedure, probably the simplest way to get into the joint so you can get adequate exposure is through a dorsal approach. And obviously, when you're fixing it, you want something that's going to be easy to do and reliable. So we'll touch on this in a little while, but this is kind of whenever I, you know, and that's not just for this procedure. Every procedure you perform, you want to look for the strongest and simplest way that's biologically friendly to perform it. So when you're performing a first metatarsal phalangeal joint fusion, there's quite a few ways that you can prepare the joint. And quite frankly, it doesn't matter how you fixated it. There is no substitute for good joint preparation. My technique of choice for first metatarsal phalangeal joint fusion is the cup and cone reamer system. And this is pretty universally accepted. I think every major MTP fusion system on the market has these types of reamers at this point. The advantage of this, it allows for flexibility in positioning the toe. You perform a cup and cone preparation, and when you're done, you have the ability to rotate, angulate, dorsiflex, plantar flex the toe into the ideal position. It's not perfect. You have to be careful when you're doing this, especially an osteoporotic bone. You can be overly aggressive and cause fracture. You know, I distinctly remember when I was a resident working with Dr. Kush at Geisinger being overly aggressive on a proximal phalanx reaming and fracturing it into, you know, dozens of pieces. The other thing is the cup and cone reamer system doesn't always work on anatomy, especially revision cases. A lot of times you open the joint and it's just flat, and it's really something where you're going to be better off with a flat cut. It's an alternative technique that we'll talk about. The other time where you're limited in your ability to do this is often if you can not get adequate exposure. In certain revision cases, there's a lot of scar tissue. The soft tissue envelope around the first metatarsophalangeal joint is inadequate to allow you to hyper plantar flex the toe, and as I like to call it, shotgun it open, in particular for exposure to the phalanx side. So, you know, in those cases, you have to have another trick up your sleeve. And typically, the other technique that's utilized is some type of flat saw cut. The nice part about this is, you know, you can do it with less exposure. So in those really tight cases, this is what you would want to turn to. The other thing, too, is by creating parallel flat cuts, if you want to do some type of lengthening, like a bone block arthrodesis, often this is easier. You can also do that with a cup and cone reamer system, but it's a little trickier. The disadvantage, though, you have to get this cut right. If you are off, what you cut is what you get. And unless you go back in and recut, you know, your angle, your toe position isn't going to be correct. You can easily put it in too much valgus, varus, plantar flexion, or dorsiflexion. And this is a game of millimeters, this type of procedure, a first metatarsophalangeal joint fusion. Where you put the toe and where it heals is exceptionally critical, and something that you know, is not forgiving once it heals. The other disadvantage of this, a little bit less surface area than the cup and cone reaming, and in many cases it'll shorten more. And obviously, any hallux surgery you're doing, you're, you know, trying to maintain length to try to prevent a transfer lesion to the lesser metatarsals. So we talked a little bit about, you know, two mechanical ways, using a saw or using a reamer. You can also do it the old-fashioned way when it comes to joint debridement, a rongeur. This takes a little bit of elbow grease. In some cases, a curette works nicely on the phalanx side. One of my personal preferences is actually if I have a joint that has a fair bit of cartilage, say, for instance, an inflammatory arthritis patient where there isn't significant cartilage loss, I'll often take the rongeur and remove the majority of the cartilage in a curette for the phalanx side and the rongeur for the metatarsal head side, trying to maintain the anatomy, and then use the cup and cone reamer. That was a little trick that was taught to me in my training, and I find when you do that, it often prepares the bone nicer, and you can ream less and have a better cancellous base for bone without cartilage pushed into it. But certainly, manual debridement works and can be done, and is what was used for years before the cup and cone reamer systems came along. Position, like I alluded to earlier, is critical. Ideally, you know, the textbook answer, you want to fuse your phalanx in regard to the metatarsal shaft in 15 to 20 degrees of valgus and 20 degrees of dorsiflexion. Now, you have to keep in mind that the metatarsal shaft typically sits in somewhere between 10 and 20 degrees of dorsiflexion relative to the floor. Quite frankly, these numbers are nice, but they're not all that practical in the operating room, unless you break scrub and put a goniometer up against the C-arm and start measuring. It's really not something that you typically can calculate during the case. So what I typically do, and the preferred technique for all the surgeons I've trained with and seen do this over the years, is to simulate weight bearing with a flat plate under the foot. And typically what you want is the toe fixed where the pad of the distal phalanx is sitting several millimeters off the plate, with the plate flat up against the heel and under the metatarsals. I'm also not afraid in a female, especially one who suggests that there's an interest in wearing higher heels, to put the toe slightly higher. In males, I tend to put it just a little bit lower. But again, you know, this is critical. Where you put this and where you fix it is where it's going to stay, assuming that it heals first time around. And I always joke around with my patients and they say diamonds are forever, but diamonds infusions are forever. And here's a picture of the flat plate that you can see intraoperatively as a way to use it. So I always make sure the scrub tech doesn't throw the tops off the cases that we're using for the surgery. The other thing too is, in addition to the flat plate, I always confirm it radiographically with AP and lateral views, because again, this is the point where you want to make it perfect, and this is the time where you want to sweat the details. There are times to go fast in the operating and slow. This is a time where you want to take a few extra minutes and make sure you have it perfect. So after you have the joint prepared and after you have the joint positioned, it's time to start fixing it. There's a bunch of different ways that you can fixate it. We'll start with the most common construct that you'll see, which is a lag screw and plate. Lag screw fixation certainly is something that has good results, but it's not perfect. There's a little bit of fiddle factor in getting a guide wire across the joint. You're coming at a relatively oblique angle. In some cases, if you're too oblique, the guide wire, when it goes intramedullary, will have difficulty penetrating. If you're going from, for example, if you're going from distal medial to proximal and lateral, the guide wire will have difficulty penetrating that lateral cortex of the metatarsal, and it'll stay intramedullary. The other, you know, disadvantage of a lag screw is you do lose some of the surface area for healing. This isn't the metatarsal phalangeal joint is not a big joint. There's not a tremendous amount of surface area. And certainly, you know, intuitively, it just makes sense. The more bone contact you have, the more robust your fusion is going to be. So something that's been done for a long time and works, but a little bit of fiddle, and it certainly takes time. And it's pretty rare that I get my guide wire in the first shot perfect, exactly where I want it. You have to measure after you put it in. You know, this type of screw, especially in the metaphyseal region of the phalanx and the metatarsal, has to be through the cortex or there's little to no strength. If your screw is too short and intramedullary, it's not going to get fixation. The flip side to that is there's certainly things around the metatarsal that you don't want to tickle with the tip of a screw or the head of a screw, in particular someone's shoe. So you have to make sure also it's not too long. And you know, the big thing is you really get one shot at this. If you put the screw in and you over tighten it, or if you put the screw in and you have to take it back out and put it in again, often you really lose the effectiveness of the screw. And in some cases in osteoporotic bone, you just don't get any significant compression. The screw just will strip or fail to hold adequately. So sometimes people to try to eliminate the screw head irritation issue will use a headless screw. And certainly they can work. They're a little bit tricky if you ever have to go back in and take one out, certainly harder than a headed screw that is easier to find. The other thing too is if you over insert one of these, let's say you are putting it in and you're trying to find that lateral cortex of the metatarsal, if you're going from distal to proximal, the screw often falls intramedullary. So what are other options? Well, in addition to lag screws, you can just use the plate as a compression tool. Advantages of compression plating, it eliminates the fiddling that's needed with the lag screw. The disadvantage is biomechanically, the lag screw and plate construct is stronger. The other thing is, if you look at the biomechanics of a dorsal compression plate, it's inclined to cause plantar flexion of the, correction, dorsiflexion of the toe, which will result in plantar gapping at the joint. To try to avoid this, what you have to do is over contour the plate, try to take a guess and see how much you have to bend the plate. So when you do tighten it down and the plate moves proximally to compress the joint, it does not pull the toe into a dorsiflex position and it doesn't open up the joint plantarly. So one of the things that Dr. Giuliano abandoned during the time I was in fellowship with him was screw-only fixation. The director at my surgery center would love if I do this because you know, a solid screw is certainly very inexpensive, but the reality of it is it's pretty tricky to get two crossing screws across the joint. You eat up a fair bit of the joint surface for fusion. And quite frankly, biomechanically, especially in soft bone, it's far inferior to plate fixation. While it may be strong enough in some patients, you probably have to alter your weight bearing. I certainly would post-operatively in my post-operative protocol as opposed to full weight bearing immediately. So a technique, but certainly something that you don't see as frequently nowadays. So in summary, talking about first metatarsophalangeal joint fusion, position is critical. The surface area of the fusion site is relatively small. Lag screws and compression plating certainly work, but they can be tricky. And the lag screw is not necessarily the best way, I think, at this point to get compression for your fusion. So why do I say that and what are we going to talk about now? Well, the ideal biomechanical construct, in my opinion, like we said earlier, something that creates a plantar tension band from a dorsal approach that is a fiddle-free system. And that's where nitinol comes along. This is something that certainly has grown in popularity among foot and ankle surgeons, and something you see more and more used in the foot for fixation. A lot of people started using them for ache and osteotomies, but you know, over time, certainly they've grown in popularity and Nitinol is really interesting stuff. The abbreviation Nitinol stands for Nickel Titanium Naval Ordnance Laboratory. It was developed by the Navy in 1959. It's a combination of 50% nickel and 50% titanium. It's not just used in surgical implants. They use it in orthodontic wires, cardiac stents, and other spots in the body as well. In regard to first metatarsal phalangeal joint fusion, the idea with the Nitinol staple is to try to create a continuous plantar compression. Now, a staple alone often is inadequate. It doesn't provide good rotational stability, and certainly it doesn't give you the security and the strength that a plate does. And the Crossroads system is unique because it combines the stability of a plate plus the compression of a staple. And that's, you know, one thing that I think you'll see, you know, the holy grail that we talked about, well, the simple dorsal exposure, the plantar tension band, the simplicity of use. I mean, it does all those things. But additionally, in something that none of the other constructs we talked about, it's a dynamic construct. If there's any resorption at the fusion site, or if there's any dorsiflexion of the hallux, the Nitinol staple is capable of closing that down. So I think this is, we're going to show you a couple of videos here that are pretty eloquent that explain this concept. So what you're looking at right here are two blocks, and there's a lag screw and plate construct, and there's ice in between. With the ice in there, the lag screw was tightened to compress them, and you can see when the ice melts, obviously nothing happens and you maintain that gap. And the purpose of this is to show what happens if you get resorption at the fusion site. Now, here are the same blocks with ice in between, with a dorsal plate and staple construct. And this time-lapse video shows the ice melting. And what you see as the ice starts to melt here, which is kind of slow, is that the gap between the bone blocks starts to close down. And when the ice goes away, the gap closes completely. And you know, this is sort of what intrigued me when I first saw this. When I first saw the concept of a plate with a staple, I thought to myself, you know, the plate's going to neutralize the effects of the staple, but it doesn't. And one of the tricks so it doesn't is you don't want to create an overly rigid construct. So when I do this, I typically use non-locking screws. I'll often use bicortical screws, unlike this diagram shows. But what's neat is, you know, and why does it work? How does it create this? Well, this is a close-up. This is looking at the non-locking screw in the same model that we just saw, zoomed in on the screw. And if you look in the top left corner of the video, you can see watching the same video. And what you can see over here is you can actually see the plate moving in relation to the screw head. So before the ice melts and after the ice melts, they took measurements. And you can see how the non-locking screw and the staple work together to allow the plate to translate and for the gap to close down. And they refer to that concept and that phenomenon as gap recovery. So why is this easy and how does it work? How do you do it? Well, if you're going to use this, this combined staple plate construct for a metatarsal phalangeal joint fusion, standard dorsal approach, that's typically what I use. The joint preparation, I typically will use a cup and cone reamer system. Some cases I'll use a flat cut if it's a revision case or there's abnormal anatomy or difficult exposure. Typically when I'm positioning, I get the toe where I think I want it and I K-wire it, not that differently than I would do with a lag screw, except this K-wire doesn't have to be as precise in positioning. It just needs to be across the joint to hold your position. At that point, you want to check, double check, triple check your alignment, use your flat plate and use your x-rays. And that's when the plate comes along. You put your plate in place. There's a line that delineates what the where the joint should be in the center portion of the plate. And you fix it with some of these little olive wires. At that point, pretty much the hard part of the case is over. From there on out, it's just drill and fill. You drill your hole when you put your staple in. There's a nice aluminum inserter that comes with the kit. You release the staple. At that point in time, I typically drill and fill non-locking screws in the remaining holes in the plate. And again, you know, to really maximize the biomechanical effects of this combination staple plate construct, the non-locking screws have been shown to work better and allow better compression afterwards. So with the staple plates, what you're going to see often is when you shoot that lateral x-ray, you'll see that the staple that you put in with parallel legs often is not parallel. And that's signs of the compression that it's created from the nitinol. And you'll feel once you put it in, it's usually pretty solid. It's not moving around. You should, assuming everything goes well, see that the gap disappears and that there's good apposition of the bony surfaces. So let's look here at a case. This is a patient I took care of last fall, 65-year-old Caucasian female. She had a past medical history significant for rheumatoid arthritis and osteoporosis. She wasn't actively smoking at the time of surgery, but she did have a 30-year PAC history of smoking. And she also had previous forefoot surgery. You can see the x-rays there. She's got an intermedullary implant in the second toe. She's got advanced arthrosis at the first metatarsophalangeal joint and also the second metatarsophalangeal joint. It looks like she's had some type of bunion procedure or severe degradation of bone in the fifth metatarsal head as well. So this patient, I performed a classic rheumatoid forefoot surgery with metatarsal head resections, PIP joint arthroplasties, and a first metatarsal phalangeal joint fusion. And this was our x-rays at 6 weeks at this point. And from the day of surgery, I make these patients full weight bearing. My typical post-op protocol is full weight bearing using a post-op shoe with a bulky dressing. Starting at 2 weeks when the staples come out, I typically convert them into a short cam boot. This patient, obviously, for her lesser metatarsals had K-wires, which were removed just before this x-ray at 6 weeks. And at 6 weeks, if you zoom in and take a close-up look at this metatarsophalangeal joint, you can see there's no resorption and excellent apposition in this patient who has relatively poor biology and very poor bone quality, who's been weight-bearing since the day of surgery. This is a CAT scan that I got on this patient. She's 2 months and 6 days post-op at the time of this CAT scan. And I have some sequential images here, which I'll flip through. You can see complete bony healing, no gapping, no loose or broken hardware. And the other thing that you can see is relatively flat plate, very low profile. If you look at the soft tissue shadow on the skin, you don't see any significant prominence. So with this patient, we got rapid complete healing. It was confirmed by CT at just over 2 months. Certainly a patient with a previous surgery, which is an independent risk factor for decreased healing, plus medical comorbidities, which have clearly been associated with decreased healing at the first metatarsophalangeal joint fusion site. Here's another patient that I have. This was a patient who had a previous non-union of a first metatarsophalangeal joint, and she had some bone loss. You can see on the lateral view there, her plate had broken and it had shortened slightly. In this case, I did a debridement, and after I debrided the joint, there was a lot of fibrous tissue and poor quality bone, and I ended up having to cut back quite a bit to get to a stable bleeding base. Certainly, I felt that the hallux would have been severely shortened, and that wasn't adequate, so I used a piece of off-the-shelf tricortical iliac crest bone graft that I used a microsagittal saw to fashion into a wafer to fit the joint, and I was able to place it and get the staple legs just on the outside of it in the native bone. And at 10 weeks post-op, weight-bearing CAT scan, confirmed healing of the joint. So another case where high risk for non-union and poor bone quality with excellent results in early healing. So in summary, the properties of the nitinol staple plus the plate are really unique. They allow for a dorsal approach with a plantar tension band. It's very simple and easy to perform, certainly less fiddling than trying to put a lag screw in. That results in saving time in the operating room. But really for me, and the thing that I think is the neatest about this is, I love when you put a lag screw in and you get great compression. Then often you'll do other work, like if you're doing a fibula fracture or a first metatarsophalangeal joint fusion where you're putting a plate on and, torquing a little bit here and there. And often what I'll do before I leave the OR is, last thing I'll do is I'll go back and I'll retighten that lag screw. And the way I think about this staple plate and this dynamic staple is every time this person pushes off on their foot before the fusion is completely healed, that staple pulls back down. And that's like being able to go back and retighten that lag screw every time they take a step. So indication risk, this is, you can read this if you like. I'm just talking a little bit about the implants. And at this point, if it's all right, I'd like to open it up to questions. First question that came in is, what's the biggest advantage of the staple versus the lag screw? And, you know, I think certainly the staple is easier and quicker, but in my mind, the biggest advantage is the dynamic nature of the staple, the nitinol, and the fact that if there's resorption or if, you know, excessive force is put across that causes the hallux to dorsiflex at all, the staple is able to close that back down. And certainly that's, I think, what results in, from in my hands, better success than just using a standard technique. Another question that was asked was, you know, why do you use non-locking screws? You know, this can be done with locking screws, but you'll get less gap recovery and less compression from the staple. And, you know, it's certainly a little bit different. For years, I've been using on my metatarsal phalangeal joint fusions, typically a independent lag screw plus a locked plate. And that creates a very rigid construct. In this case, you create a construct that has a little bit more flexibility, and the non-locking screws allow the plate to maintain a dynamic nature. And I really think that makes a big difference. You know, you don't see those, you know, 6-8 week post-op x-rays where it looks like there's a gap and then you're holding your breath hoping that it fills in by 3 or 4 months with bridging bone. You know, with these, I typically see no gap from the time of surgery until I get my CAT scan confirming they're healed. So another question that was asked is, do you ever lose alignment of the toe after putting in the staple and before putting in the screws? And how do you fix it? How do you prevent it? So I found that, well, my typical technique is I position the toe and I usually just throw a temporary crossing K-wire to hold it. At that point in time, if I like where my toe is positioned, where the hallux is in relation to the metatarsal on x-rays and with simulated weight bearing using a flat plate, I'll then apply the dorsal crossroads plate and I'll fixate it with two olive wires. I typically, between the two olive wires and the crossing K wire, don't lose fixation. But if I did at that point, you know, that's the time to readjust it. If you put the staple in and the toe moves a little bit, you still have the ability to rotate the toe side to side or up and down a little bit before you fixate the plate as well. So certainly you have the opportunity. And the other thing is, these staples with the inserter are very easy to take back out. The inserter, if you look at the staple from a side view, there are these little small overhangs. And the inserter puts a 3-point bend, which opens up the prongs. So taking it back out and repositioning if you need to remove the staple is really quite easy. And you can do it without causing any, you know, widening of the staple hole that you created. All right, let's see. I just saw a question saying, what plate do you typically use? I typically use either a straight or a 5-degree dorsiflexion plate. Let's see, you know what? I'm not sure that. Is that the question? Let's see. Okay. Yep. That was it. So that's typically what I use. But honestly, when I'm looking at this, I just sort of I eyeball the toe and kind of before I decide which plate I'm going to use. I usually have all options available, and then after I have my toe provisionally fixated with the K wire and I'm happy with the position, I look at it. One thing is, you know, and I'm sure most of you guys who have done this numerous times, sometimes you do get some dorsal bone at the joint surface. And if I need to, sometimes I'll just take a saw and flatten that out just to make sure that the plate sits nice and flush and it's not you know, prominent or seesawing on top of that. So I got a question. Is the length of the clip or staple ever an issue? Do you hope for bicortical purchase of those legs? So that's a great question. I've never had a patient who is too small for a staple that I couldn't use it. Bicortical purchase, you have to be careful because the proximally in the metatarsal, this staple is going to be typically exiting somewhere around the sesamoids, and certainly you wouldn't want that to be irritating the sesamoids. So typically I don't use a bicortical staple for these, and I've really not had any trouble with that. Another question here, you know, how do you feel about staple only fusion? I've never tried that. I'll be honest. I really like the stability of the plate from the ability to control rotation and maintain, you know, better alignment. And I think that is so critical in this procedure. So I haven't done staple only fusion. I've seen it done. I've actually messed around with it on cadavers, and there's some pretty interesting new Crossroads products that are coming along that may allow for that. But I'll be honest, this is working so well in my hands, and I've had such good success that I'm at this point hard pressed to mess with it. And then there's another question here. It says, do I ever need to remove the plate? I have had to take one of these out. It was for a diabetic gentleman who postoperatively got an infection. We were able, with the help of my infectious disease doctor, took him back, washed him out. I used some Stimulan beads, which are a antibiotic bead that can absorb, and that plus IV antibiotics. We were able to suppress the infection adequately and provide, you know, local wound care and actually achieve fusion. We got a septic fusion, and then I went back in and took the plates out. Taking the plates out, no problem whatsoever. I used the non-locking screws. They came out easily. Staple, I typically, what I do is put a little freer elevator underneath it, just pry it up a couple millimeters. Once you get it just a few millimeters off, you can put the inserter that you used to put it in back on the staple. When you tighten that down, it applies a three-point bend, which unlocks the prongs. It opens up and sort of counteracts the nitinol's compression. And as soon as you do that, it just slides right out. So I have a question here, and it's asking about a competitor's plate. I'm not sure if I'm allowed to mention the name, but it's a plate that has I believe it's correct one, it has a combined plate with a pocket for a leg screw in it. I have used these plates before, and really I think it's quite simple. This provides and the reason that I choose this construct is it provides a plantar tension band, but more importantly, it provides a dynamic construct. And it's neat. Crossroads, if you talk to their rep, they have this little model where there's a little piece of plastic that goes in between at the first metatarsal phalangeal joint to simulate what a fusion would be like. And you can pull it out and you can watch this close down. So if you have a patient where there's bony resorption at the fusion site, or if you have someone who's really torquing on it, you can loosen up a regular plate and screw. If you do that to this one, there's a very good chance it's going to close down like I showed in those ice block videos. Let's just see. I want to make sure I got all the questions. There may have been some earlier. So there was one question. Is there any advice for someone who likes to make straight cuts? So, you know, I think the big thing with your straight cuts is you just want to be really careful about positioning it. And obviously the other thing too is you want to make sure that you minimize your bone resection. Like I said earlier, I typically reserve these for, I usually find myself doing that in revision cases. The name of the game, I think, when you're making a straight cut and the way that I do it, I take away as little bone as I have to, and I kind of work myself from there. The last thing you want to do is cut out a big hunk and then have a toe that's way too short. I have a friend, and we argue about this sometime. He's a great foot and ankle surgeon. He does a lot of straight cuts. He also does a lot of wild osteotomies. And I tease him and I say, you know, that's because you shortened it up so much, you have to go shorten the other ones to make up for it. So, but certainly it can be done. And like I showed in that one revision case that I did with the bone block, it works quite well for those.
All right. If we don't have any other questions, thank you again, Dr. Campbell. We appreciate your time and your contribution this evening.
Thank you, Lisa. I appreciate the opportunity. And thanks to everyone who signed on and watched.